Hello and welcome to yet another lesson on the Business Regulatory Framework. Today's lesson deals with the meaning and characteristics of the negotiable instruments under the Business Regulatory Framework. This lesson will enable you to understand the meaning, essential characteristics, and recognize the types of negotiable instruments. It will also discuss and describe the meaning and marketing of checks, crossing of checks, and the cancellation of crossing of a check. The episode will explain the capacity and liability parties have to negotiable instruments, as well as be aware of negotiation, assignment, endorsement, acceptance, and so on of the negotiable instruments. I am Amrita Ghosh Kumar, and the subject expert for this lesson is Dr. Seema Miraj, who has a specialization in human resource management. Let us now get a broad overview of the concept of the negotiable instruments. The Negotiable Instruments Act was enacted in India in 1881. It extends to the whole of India except the state of Jammu and Kashmir. The Act operates subject to the provisions of sections 31 and 32 of the Reserve Bank of India Act. According to section 13A of the Act, negotiable instrument means a promissory note, bill of exchange or check payable either to order or to bearer, whether the word order or bearer appears on the instrument or not. Thus, the term negotiable instrument means a written document which creates a right in favor of some person and which is freely transferable. Although the Act mentions only these three instruments, as in a promissory note, a bill of exchange, and a check, it does not exclude the possibility of adding any other instrument which satisfies the following two conditions of negotiability. 1. The instrument should be freely transferable. 2. The person who obtains it in good faith and for value should get it free from all defects and be entitled to recover the money of the instrument in his own name. As such, documents like shares, warrants payable to bearer, debentures payable to bearer and dividend warrants are negotiable instruments. But the money orders and postal orders, deposit receipts, share certificates, bill of lading, dock warrant, etc. are not negotiable instruments. Although they are transferable by delivery and endorsements, yet they are not able to give a better title to the bona fide transferee for value than what the transferor has. A negotiable instrument has the following characteristics. 1. Property. The possessor of the negotiable instrument is presumed to be the owner of the property contained therein. A negotiable instrument does not merely give possession of the instrument, but the right to the property also. The property in a negotiable instrument can be transferred without any formality. 2. Title. The transferee of a negotiable instrument is known as holder in due course. 3. Rights. The transferee of the negotiable instrument can sue in his own name in case of dishonor. A negotiable instrument can be transferred any number of times till it is at maturity. The holder of the instrument need not give notice of transfer to the party liable on the instrument to pay. 4. Presumptions. Certain presumptions apply to all negotiable instruments. Example, a presumption that consideration has been paid under it. It is not necessary to write in a promissory note the words for value received or similar expressions because the payment of consideration is presumed. 5. Prompt payment. A negotiable instrument enables the holder to expect prompt payment, because a dishonor means the ruin of the credit of all persons who are parties to the instrument. One, promissory notes. Two, bills of exchange. Three, checks. Negotiable instruments recognized by usage or custom are 1. Hundis, 2. Share warrants, 3. Dividend warrants, 4. Banker's draft, 5. Circular notes, 6. Bearer debentures, 7. Debentures of Bombay Port Trust, 8. Railway receipts, 9. Delivery orders. Section 4 of the Act defines, a promissory note is an instrument in writing, note being a banknote or a currency note, containing an unconditional undertaking signed by the maker to pay a certain sum of money to or to the order of a certain person or to the bearer of the instruments. Essential elements. 1. It must be in writing. 2. It must certainly an express promise or clear understanding to pay. The following are not promissory notes, as there is no promise to pay. If A writes, A, Mr. B, I owe you rupees 500. B, I am liable to pay you rupees 500. C, I have taken it from you rupees 100. Whenever you ask for it, I have to pay. The following will be taken as promissory notes because there is an express promise to pay. If A writes, A, I promise to pay B or order rupees 500. B, I acknowledge myself to be indebted to B in rupees 1000 to be paid on demand for the value received. 3, promise to pay must be unconditional. A conditional undertaking destroys the negotiable character of an otherwise negotiable instrument. Therefore, the promise to pay must not depend upon the happening of some outside contingency or event. It must be payable absolutely. Number 4, it should be signed by the maker. The person who promises to pay must sign the instrument, even though it might have been written by the promisor himself. Number 5, the maker must be certain. The note self must show clearly who is the person who is agreeing to undertake the liability to pay the amount. Number 6, the payee must be certain. The instrument must point out with certainty the person to whom the promise has been made. The payee may be ascertained by name or by designation. Number 7, the promise should be to pay money and money only. Money means legal tender money and not old and rare coins. 8, the amount should be certain. One of the important characteristics of a promissory note is certainty, not only regarding the person to whom or by whom payment is to be made, but also regarding the amount. Number 9, other formalities. The other formalities regarding number, place, date, consideration, and so on, though usually found given in the promissory notes, but are not essential in law. Section 5 of the Act defines, a bill of exchange is an instrument in writing containing an unconditional order signed by the maker directing a certain person to pay a certain sum of money only to or to the order of a certain person or to the bearer of the instrument. A bill of exchange, therefore, is a written acknowledgement of the debt written by the creditor and accepted by the debtor. There are usually three parties to a bill of exchange: drawer, acceptor or drawee, and payee. The drawer himself may be the payee. Essential conditions of a bill of exchange. 1. It must be in writing. 2, it must be signed by the drawer. 3, the drawer, drawee and payee must be certain. 4, the sum payable must also be certain. 5, it should be properly stamped. 6, it must contain an express order to pay money and money alone. For example, in the following cases, there is no order to pay but only a request to pay. Therefore, none can be considered as a bill of exchange. A. I shall be highly obliged if you make it convenient to pay rupees 1000 to Suresh. B. Mr. Ramesh, please let the bearer have 1000 rupees and place it to my account and oblige. However, there is an order to pay, though it is politely made in the following examples. A. Please pay rupees 500 to the order of A. B. Mr. A will oblige Mr. C by paying to the order of P. 7. Classification of bills. Bills can be classified as 1. Inland and foreign bills. 2. Time and demand bills. 3. Trade and accommodation bills. 1. Inland and foreign bills. Inland bill. A bill is named as an inland bill if A. it is drawn in India on a person residing in India, whether payable in or outside India, or B. it is drawn in India on a person residing outside India but payable in India. Foreign bill. A bill which is not an inland bill is a foreign bill. The following are the foreign bills. Number 1. A bill drawn outside India and made payable in India. Number 2. A bill drawn outside India on any person residing outside India. Number 2. Time and demand bill. Time bill. A bill payable after a fixed time is termed as a time bill. In other words, bill payable after date is a time bill. Demand bill. A bill payable at sight or on demand is termed as a demand bill. Number 3. Trade and accommodation bill. Trade bill. A bill drawn and accepted for a genuine trade transaction is termed as a trade bill. Accommodation bill. A bill drawn and accepted not for a genuine trade transaction but only to provide financial help to some party is termed as an accommodation bill. A hundi is a negotiable instrument written in an oriental language. The term hundi includes all indigenous negotiable instruments, whether they are in the form of notes or bills. The word hundi is said to be derived from the Sanskrit word hundi, which means to collect. They are quite popular among the Indian merchants from very old days. They are used to finance trade and commerce and provide a facile and sound medium of currency and credit. Hundis are governed by the custom and usage of the locality in which they are intended to be used and not by the provision of the Negotiable Instruments Act. In case there is no customary rule known as to a certain point, the court may apply the provisions of the Negotiable Instruments Act. Holder in due course as any person who, 1, for valuable consideration, 2, becomes the possessor of a negotiable instrument payable to bearer or the endorsee or payee thereof, number 3, before the amount mentioned in the document becomes payable, and number 4, without having sufficient cause to believe that any defect existed in the title of the person from whom he derives his title. The essential qualification of a holder in due course may therefore be summed up as follows. 1. He must be a holder for valuable consideration. 2. He must have become a holder of the negotiable instrument in good faith. Number 3, a holder in due course must take the negotiable instrument complete and regular on the face of it. Number 4, no effect of absence of consideration or presence of an unlawful consideration. The plea of absence of or unlawful consideration is not available against the holder in due course. Number 5, rights not affected in case of an inchoate instrument. Right of a holder in due course to recover money is not at all affected even though the instrument was originally an inchoate stamped instrument and the transferor completed the instrument for a sum greater than what was intended by the maker. Number 6, all prior parties liable. All prior parties to the instrument continue to remain liable to the holder in due course until the instrument is satisfied. Negotiation may be defined as the process by which a third party is constituted the holder of the instrument so as to entitle him to the possession of the same and to receive the amount due thereon in his own name. According to Section 14 of the Act, when a promissory note, bill of exchange or check is transferred to any person so as to constitute that person the holder thereof, the instrument is said to be negotiated. The main purpose and essence of negotiation is to make the transferee of a promissory note, a bill of exchange or a check the holder thereof. Negotiation thus requires two conditions to be fulfilled. Namely, one, there must be a transfer of the instrument to another person, and two, the transfer must be made in such a manner as to constitute the transferee the holder of the instrument. Negotiation may be effected in the following two ways. 1. Negotiation by delivery. Section 47. Where a promissory note or a bill of exchange or a check is payable to a bearer, it may be negotiated by delivery thereof. Example, A. The holder of a negotiable instrument payable to bearer delivers it to B's agent to keep it for B. The instrument has been negotiated. Number 2, negotiation by endorsement and delivery. Section 48. A promissory note, a check or a bill of exchange payable to order can be negotiated only by endorsement and delivery. Unless the holder signs his endorsement on the instrument and delivers it, the transferee does not become a holder. If there are more payees than one, all must endorse it. When a negotiable instrument is dishonored, the holder must give a notice of dishonor to all the previous parties in order to make them liable. A negotiable instrument can be dishonored either by no acceptance or by non-payment. A check and a promissory note can only be dishonored by non-payment, but a bill of exchange can be dishonored either by non-payment or by non-acceptance. Dishonor by non-acceptance. Section 91. A bill of exchange can be dishonored by non-acceptance in the following ways. 1. If a bill is presented to the drawee for acceptance and he does not accept it within 48 hours from the time of presentance of acceptance. When there are several drawees, even if one of them makes a default in acceptance, the bill is deemed to be dishonored unless these several drawees are partners. Ordinarily, when there are a number of drawees, all of them must accept the same. But when the drawees are partner, acceptance by one of them means acceptance by all. Number 2, when the drawee is a fictitious person or if he cannot be traced after reasonable search. Number 3, when the drawee is incompetent to contract, the bill is treated as dishonored. Number 4, when a bill is accepted with a qualified acceptance, the holder may treat the bill of exchange as having been dishonored. Number 5, when the drawee has either become insolvent or is dead. Dishonor by non-payment. A bill after being accepted has got to be presented for payment on the date of its maturity. If the acceptor fails to make payment when it is due, the bill is dishonored by non-payment. In the case of a promissory note, if the maker fails to make payment on the due date, the note is dishonored by non-payment. A check is dishonored by non-payment as soon as a banker refuses to pay. An instrument is also dishonored by non-payment when presentment for payment is excused and the instrument when overdue remains unpaid. Effect of dishonor. When a negotiable instrument is dishonored, either by non-acceptance or by non-payment, the other parties thereto can be charged with liability. Notice of dishonor. Notice of dishonor means the actual notification of the dishonor of the instrument by non-acceptance or by non-payment. Notice by whom? Where a negotiable instrument is dishonored either by non-acceptance or by non-payment, the holder of the instrument or some party to it who is liable thereon must give a notice of dishonor to all the prior parties whom he wants to make liable on the instrument. Mode of notice. The notice of dishonor may be oral or written or partly oral and partly written. It may be sent by post. What is reasonable time? It is not possible to lay down any hard and fast rule for determining what is reasonable time. Place of notice. The place of business, or in case such party has no place of business at the residence of the party for whom it is intended, is the place where the notice is to be given. Section 6 of the Act defines, a check is a bill of exchange drawn on a specified banker and not expressed to be payable otherwise than on demand. A check is a bill of exchange with two more qualifications. Namely, 1, it is always drawn on a specified banker, and number 2, it is always payable on demand. All check is bill of exchange, but all bills are not check. A check must satisfy all the requirements of a bill of exchange. That is, it must be signed by the drawer and must contain an unconditional order on a specified banker to pay a certain sum of money to or to the order of a certain person or to the bearer of the check. It does not require acceptance. A check is a negotiable instrument. During the process of circulation, a check may be lost, stolen, or the signature of payee may be done by some other person for endorsing it. Under these circumstances, the check may go into wrong hands. Crossing is a popular device for protecting the drawer and the payee of a check. Both bearer and order checks can be crossed. Crossing prevents fraud and wrong payments. Crossing of a check means drawing two parallel lines across the face of the check. Thus, crossing is necessary in order to have safety. Cross checks must be presented through the bank only because they are not paid at the counter. 1. General crossing. Generally, checks are crossed when there are two transverse parallel lines marked across its face, or the check bears an abbreviation AND CO between the two parallel lines, or the check bears the words NOT NEGOTIABLE between the two parallel lines, or the check bears the words ACCOUNT PAY between the two parallel lines. A cross check can be made bearer check by cancelling the crossing and writing that the crossing is cancelled and affixing the full signature of the drawer. 2. Special or restrictive crossing. When a particular bank's name is written in between the two parallel lines, the check is said to be specially crossed. In addition to the word bank, the words account payee only, not negotiable may also be written. The payment of such checks is not made unless the bank named in crossing is presenting the check. The effect of special crossing is that the bank makes payment only to the banker whose name is written in the crossing. Specially crossed checks are safer than generally crossed checks. Let us now quickly summarize what we have learned today. We have discussed the meaning, the characteristics, and the different types of negotiable instruments. Capacity and liability parties have to negotiable instruments, and the provisions of the Negotiable Instruments Act 1881. That is all we have for you today. Hope you have understood the concept of negotiable instruments. We will see you again soon with another topic on business regulatory framework. Till then, take care. Bye-bye.